Hello dear students, this is Dr. N. Usha Rani. Today I am going to give a small description of quality control of glass containers. Glass containers, especially that are used in pharmaceutical industry as packaging material. Apart from glass containers, the other packaging materials are like the plastic containers, metal containers, then the secondary packaging materials like the cartons, wooden boxes, etc. All these form an integral part of the pharmaceutical industry. These packaging materials affect the quality, safety and efficacy of the drug products. Hence, the quality control of these packaging materials forms a very significant activity in pharmaceutical industry. These materials actually protect the product from the outer atmosphere and also prevent the loss of the drug product. At the same time, these packaging materials should not react physically or chemically with the drug product and affect the quality beyond the limits that are mentioned in the monographs in Indian Pharmacopoeia. All the tests that we discuss here are the specifications and guidelines given by different regulatory bodies like WHO, ICH, USFDA guidelines, etc., GMPs also. So hence, dear students, now we'll go into the description of quality control of glass containers. Especially glass containers are used for packaging of parenteral products. So in the picture, you can see different glass containers like bottles, vials, ampoules, etc. that are used to pack the parenteral products. The different tests for the glass containers are the surface hydrolytic resistance test, surface hydrolytic resistance test for powdered glass, light transmission test for colored glass, then test for resistance to thermal shock, then test for arsenic. Out of all the tests, these are the most primary tests that have to be performed on the glass containers. And coming to the hydrolytic resistance test, these are of two types, that is surface hydrolytic resistance test and powdered glass hydrolytic resistance test. The principle behind is same. Like here, in this particular test, the amount of alkali that is leached from the glass material into the drug product is estimated by using a standard assay. Let's go into the details of the test here. So the table here shows you the different capacities of the bottles and the different number of containers that you have to use and the volume of the test solution that has to be used to perform the test. So once again, the table shows you the different capacities of the bottles, the different number of containers correspondingly that have to be used, and the volume of the test solution that has to be used to perform the test. The test details are like this, like you have to wash the glass container with the carbon dioxide free water, then fill it with the carbon dioxide free water, then autoclave the container along with water at 120 degrees centigrade for 60 minutes. Then take out the sample, take an aliquot of the sample from the bottle and then titrate against 0.01 normal hydrochloric acid. So here definitely, if at all any alkali has leached from the glass material, it will react with this acid and neutralization reaction takes place and you get the end point. And the amount of HCl that is consumed to get the neutralization point or the end point usually gives us the amount of alkali that is leached from the glass material, and this titer value will be compared with the specifications that are mentioned in IP. So here is a table that is showing the Indian Pharmacopoeia specifications. Like you can see on the left hand side the different capacities of the bottles, and the middle column shows you for type 1 and type 2 glass the titer value that you have to get, and for the type 3 glass the titer value that you have to get. So whatever value you get in the experiment or the experimental value should be compared with the standard values that are mentioned in the pharmacopoeia. Then test for hydrolytic resistance test of the powdered glass. This is almost same as the previous one. The only difference is here you have to hammer the container and make it into fragments. Out of it you take 20 grams of the fragments, and the size of the fragments must be so that they retain on 250 micron sieve but pass through 425 micron sieve. This is the size specification for the fragments as mentioned in IP. Then pass the fragments through a magnet to remove any metal impurities, especially iron, and then you take these fragments into a bottle, then add carbon dioxide free water, and then you have to take out the sample and then check if at all any alkali has leached into the carbon dioxide free water. So it is same as the previous one. The only difference is here you take the powdered fragments, and previous test is with the entire container. But here also you take the carbon dioxide free water, add it to the fragments and autoclave it, then remove the sample and then titrate with the standard acid, and then compare the titer value with the IP specifications. Then light transmission test for colored glass. Here also you have to break the container with a carborundum or a diamond wheel, then select the wall section or a broken wall piece of the container, then place it into a spectrophotometer and measure the transmittance of light. You have to place the glass piece in the spectrophotometer such a way that the light beam passes perpendicularly through the wall section of the glass piece. Then you measure the transmission of light in the spectral region of 290 to 450 nanometers wavelength with an interval of 20 nanometers for each reading, and you have to observe that the transmission is not more than 10% at any wavelength range in the range of 290 to 450 nanometers irrespective of the type and capacity of the container. Then test for resistance to thermal shock. Here particularly this test is done whenever you fill the blood products or biological products. Here you have to empty the glass container, then place the empty container in an autoclave for 140 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. Then next you have to place it in the oven at 250 degrees centigrade for 1 hour. Then fill 70% of the container with 0.9% sodium chloride, then cool to around minus 20 degrees centigrade, and then again restore to the room temperature. After restoring to the room temperature, the container must comply with the test for resistance to centrifugation. So students, let's see what the test for resistance to centrifugation is. Here you have to acidify the water with 2 molar HCl, then fill this acidified water into the container up to its nominal capacity. Then you envelop this entire container with a paper that is impregnated with a dye solution, especially a bromophenol blue solution. Then place it in the centrifuge, and then centrifuge the sample at 5000 RPM for 10 minutes. Then no leakage should be detected on the indicator paper. So if at all any leakage is there, then you can see the change on the indicator paper. And also you can see that the dye solution enters into the water that is taken into the bottle, and you can see the change in the color of the water that is present inside the container. Then test for heavy metals like arsenic. Here you can carry out the test on ampoules. The inner and outer surfaces are washed 5 times with freshly distilled water. Then you have to prepare a test solution as described in the hydrolytic resistance test previously. The sample must be around 5 ml, then 50 ml. From this 50 ml you have to take around 10 ml of the test solution from the combined contents of all the ampoules that are taken for the test and pull it up into a flask. Then add 10 ml of nitric acid and then evaporate to dryness, then by using a water bath, and then dry the residue in an oven at 130 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. Then cool the residue, add the reagent like hydrazine molybdate, then reflux it for around 20 minutes, then cool to room temperature, and then measure the absorbance of the sample at 840 nanometers using hydrazine molybdate reagent as blank. Here the observation must be like, the absorbance of the test solution must not exceed the absorbance of the standard arsenic solution that is used to compare. These are the non-pharmacopeial tests for glass containers, like the total height, body diameter, neck capacity, overflow capacity. For all these parameters, the tolerance limits are 2 mm and 2 ml respectively. And these are the references. Thank you. So I want to conclude by saying that quality control of glass containers forms a very integral part of QC of packaging materials in pharmaceutical industries. The materials that are used must not be very expensive, and at the same time they should not affect the quality of the product.